This is a president who lives in the world of no regret because he never admits he makes a mistake.
Speaks for himself. The bigots that were in Charlottesville, they want to tear us apart.
It's time for my colleagues to start putting country in the party.
There's a consensus developing in the military that Donald Trump is unfit to be the president.
Lose situation and doing what is morally right.
Out of something terrible comes a beautiful show of love and unity.
She put her body on the line in front of white supremacists and gave her life.
They tried to kill my child to shut her up. Well, guess what? You just magnified her.
This is New Day with Chris Cuomo and Alisyn Camerota.
Good morning. Welcome to your new day. Alisyn is off. Poppy Harlow joining me. Good to have you this week.
My pleasure.
A community coming together. Hundreds turning out in Charlottesville, singing songs of hope. Listen.
We all need somebody to lead on.
This was an impromptu candlelight vigil honoring Heather Heyer at the very location where hate groups marched with torches and Nazi signs just days ago. The escalating crisis over President Trump's response has the president fighting back this morning, denying his own words, his moral equivocation, that hate groups and those protesting them shared responsibility.
And the revolt against President Trump's response is growing louder and louder from former Republican presidents and CEOs to the president's own military generals, and that is rare and stunning and notable. But Republicans in Congress largely avoiding attacking the president by name. And this comes as a president, we are told, remains defiant and without regret over his defense of white supremacists. We have it all covered for you. Let's go to our Jeff Zeleny in Bridgewater, New Jersey, where the president is. And Jeff, that's your reporting. That is from people that have been with the president in the last 24 hours.
Good morning, Poppy. That's correct. They saying no regret. And we are seeing that play out in real time again this morning. The president back at Bedminster, his golf course and resort, tweeting this morning. You get the sense this is going to be a heavy day for the president, on Twitter at least. He is directly going after one of those Republicans in tweets just sent out earlier this morning. Senator Lindsey Graham, Republican of South Carolina, was one of the ones who directly confronted the president. So the president fought back this morning with these tweets, saying publicity-seeking Lindsey Graham falsely stated that I said there's no moral equivalency between the KKK, neo-Nazis, and white supremacists, and people like Ms. Heyer, he went on to say. Such a disgusting lie. He just can't forget his election trouncing. The people of South Carolina will remember. So all that is coming as the president is increasingly sensitive, isolated from Republicans, but also business leaders.
President Trump, defiant in the wake of a growing backlash over his combative response to deadly violence at a white supremacy rally in Charlottesville.
Jews will not replace us!
I think there's blame on both sides, and I have no doubt about it.
Two sources tell CNN the president is moving forward without regret, believing firmly that the media and East Coast elites are unfairly upset about his remarks.
What about the alt-left that came charging at the, as you say, the alt-right? Do they have any semblance of guilt?
But the president's words have caused a major break between him and some of the nation's top business leaders. Three executives tell CNN that after the president's off-the-rails press conference on Tuesday, CEOs serving on the president's strategic and policy forum decided to dissolve the group. But before they could make the announcement, the president acted first, tweeting that he is dismantling both his policy and manufacturing panels, despite boasting 24 hours earlier about having many business leaders to replace the CEOs who were distancing themselves from the White House. The revolt doesn't stop there. Five armed services chiefs also countering their commander-in-chief with public condemnations of white supremacy on Twitter, although none mentioned President Trump by name.
I don't believe that you can be a fine person and a white supremacist. They're mutually exclusive. Can't use them in the same line.
Many Republicans also denouncing the president's remarks, although the majority of the party and its leadership have not explicitly condemned Mr. Trump by name.
You know, the president speaks for himself.
Within the White House, many of the president's aides have privately expressed frustration, but there have been no resignations. And sources tell CNN it's a safe assumption for now nobody is stepping down. Chief Economic Advisor Gary Cohn, who is Jewish, is said to be disappointed and embarrassed, while the president's Jewish daughter and son-in-law have yet to comment.
I stand with the president, and I stand by those words.
Vice President Pence, who is abruptly cutting his international trip short to return to the U.S., defending the president, but declining to answer direct questions about his remarks. The fallout comes as hundreds gathered for a peaceful march and candlelight vigil at the University of Virginia campus, the very site where white supremacists carried torches and Nazi flags that led to the violence. The Charlottesville community coming together to heal and pay tribute to Heather Heyer, whose mother had this message for those who hate.
They tried to kill my child to shut her up. Well, guess what? You just magnified her.
So the president is taking aim at more Republicans this morning in a tweet out just a few moments ago, going after Senator Jeff Flake, Republican of Arizona, who has also been critical of this president. He said this, let's read it. He said, great to see that Dr. Kelly Ward is running against Flake. Jeff Flake, who is weak on borders, crime, and a non-factor in the Senate. He's toxic. Well, clearly the president has Arizona on his mind. He announced last night he's planning to do a campaign-style rally next week in Phoenix, likely to have Jeff Flake's Republican opponent at his side. She's been a major Trump supporter. Now, all this is coming as the mayor of Phoenix, a Democrat, last night sent out a statement urging the president, asking the president not to come to Phoenix in the wake of Charlottesville. He asked him to delay that rally. I think the sign of this tweet this morning, Chris and Poppy, is a sign that the president will be in Phoenix.
All right, Jeff, appreciate the reporting. Let's bring in our panel, CNN political commentator Errol Lewis, CNN political director David Chalian, and CNN political analyst David Gregory. David Gregory, do we think for all the ugliness here, we may also have a moment of clarity? Do we now know where President Trump's head is, that he is all in with his base, so much so that, of course, he'll attack us for reporting his own words? That's easy. We know about that. Going after Graham, going after Flake, he needs these two men to get his agenda passed. Right. He might need these two men to save him from any kind of political test of his legitimacy right. That comes up. He needs the votes. And yet he is attacking them in deference to his base.
I think this is a moment of clarity. I think even by Trump standards, we've reached an extraordinary time in this young presidency where there are real questions about President Trump's judgment, his temperament, and his fitness to lead as president of the United States. I'm not sure the moment of clarity is about any particular label, although what is significant about the past few days is that white supremacists think they have an ally in the White House. Mm-hmm. That is reprehensible, and it's because of his conduct. I also think part of what makes this moment extraordinary is look around, whether it's business leaders in America, military, the heads of our military branches, members of the president's own party, former President Bush and his father, former President Bush, speaking out against this president. He is increasingly isolated and ever more immature, lashing out at members of his own party. This isn't leadership. He's not governing. He's simply lashing out at everyone around him. He's got a dysfunctional White House staff and a kind of paralyzed agenda, as I can see. Mm-hmm. So it's bad for the country. It's certainly bad for him politically, bad for his party. And it's not clear where he maneuvers now, because everything he tries to do to rehabilitate himself or the conduct of his presidency, he gets in the way of.
He can blame and point fingers at David Chalian, whomever he would like. That is his right as an American and as the president. However, he needs to listen to the words of the people that are embracing him. We're going to have the reporter on in just a few minutes, that incredible Vice reporter who was in the midst of all of this, okay? On CNN last night, she was asked, what are the white supremacists saying about the president's response to all this? And they said they love it. The president continues to exceed the expectations of the white nationalists. One texted me last night and said, my God, I love this man. He really has my back. Those are voices that the president does not seem to be hearing, David Chalian.
It doesn't seem to bother him at all that those voices are out there and that those folks can take comfort. They feel they can take comfort in what President Trump says. Let's be clear about what he's doing now this morning, obviously. He is desperate for an enemy. Everything David Gregory just said, completely true. Yeah. But I would just say that questions about his character, his temperament, his fitness for the job, majority of Americans had questions about that last November in the election. What he had last November that he doesn't have now as president is an opponent who he is running against. And so that's what this lashing out is on Twitter. He is desperate to get back into a place like he did with Little Marco or Crooked Hillary or Lion Ted, right, and form opponents here so that he can find a way to build back up. This is this is almost like Donald Trump paint by numbers. He is rocked by the coverage. He then leaks out word that there's no regret, no turning back at all, no apologies whatsoever. And then he starts lashing out to find opponents to try to begin to gather some support among his core.
So I would just add to that that I think that's true. He had Hillary Clinton as an opponent. He has the media now. He has anybody, all comers, essentially. But I think people who supported Trump were willing to forgive these character questions, thinking, yeah, that's a lot of noise, but he's going to get here and change things, and he'll be able to govern. Now I think it's a new set of questions.
That's right. No, David, I think you're spot on. Errol, I mean, look, he's taking out the people he needs to get the agenda going. Lindsey Graham is wired any way you look at it. Jeff Flake, as we know, is one of the main mechanics in there. And you may disagree within your own party, but you don't handle it this way. And we're seeing something else. In the aftermath of what he said about Charlottesville, the people who are backing him, at least in social media, and we get a pretty good study of it there, and certainly the president is responsive to it, they are almost to a person saying one thing. Well, yeah, KKK is bad, but what about Antifa? What about BLM? You know, isn't that the left's version? That's what the president was pandering to. This notion they had when he first got elected, DJT 100, become popular at 100%, everybody's president. Those hopes seem to have been abandoned, which means Steve Bannon can't be going anywhere anytime soon.
Well, that's right. I don't think Steve Bannon's going anywhere. There's this extraordinary interview that Bob Kuttner got, and that's going to be news today. But look, the reality is we keep talking about the president's agenda and whether or not he's going to be able to accomplish it. The uncomfortable truth is that what we saw at that chaotic press conference in the lobby of Trump Tower, that is the president's agenda. For a lot of people, that's what he's delivering. They care about that more than they care about jobs, more than they care about the economy, more than they care about America's standing in the world or making America great. For them, the sight of a combative president taking on enemies, inventing enemies if possible, if necessary, sort of being vulgar and disdainful, shattering all of the norms of political discourse, that's the payoff for a lot of a certain number of his voters. It's a depressing truth of the Trump presidency. The fact that he's chosen to do that is a leadership vacuum, because the president is not just supposed to be pandering. He's supposed to be doing certain things.
Here's one lens into how Americans are feeling about all this morning. There's this new Marist poll out on how the president's reaction to Charlottesville was. Now, 52% of Americans, David Gregory, say not strong enough. A little over a quarter of Americans do say strong enough. I should note this was taken Monday and Tuesday, so some of the respondents wouldn't have seen that Tuesday afternoon, press conference that the president gave that was so stunning and remarkable, where he doubled down on this, you know, moral equivalency. But still, do those numbers surprise you?
Well, it's a snapshot in one particular time without some of the consequences of him shifting his position and going back to his original moral equivocations. I don't think that's as important as the larger point about what's happening here. What Errol just said about Donald Trump is filling a vacuum right now in the country for people who support him, who feel alienated, who feel outside of the political system. But he also had support of tried and true Republicans who kind of came home because they opposed Hillary Clinton, because they didn't like what was happening in Washington, and so on. That you're seeing kind of filleted up a little bit, where Republican support is getting much softer. It hadn't collapsed, but it's getting softer. The bigger challenge, I think, for the establishment of both parties is to begin to deal with some of these questions that are dividing Americans so sharply, ideological questions, social questions, and not let Donald Trump or not let the fringy elements of his support, like these supremacists, dictate that conversation, whether it's about race or national memory, about this, you know, the Confederacy. We have to have a broader conversation that is not led by these forces.
Well, except David. Chalian, the reason that I say this is a moment of clarity is that clearly that's what the president has decided to do, whether because of Bannon and similar advisors or his own head and heart are telling him, look, we've got a third. Let's lock in that third and let's hope the independents will swing our way because they hate what we're inventing as a deep state and that the institutions there that we're fighting against are the real enemy and we'll be okay. It has to be the play. Otherwise, what he'd be doing now is political suicide.
I agree with you that that's the play, Chris. And I don't think that just got revealed with his nonsensical moral equivalency this week. I think that has been revealed in the way he's governed for 7 months. I constantly challenge folks to point to something the president has done in his first 7 months that seemed geared at garnering a majority of the American support behind it, of pointing to something and then taking a majority of the country following him, as leaders tend to do. I think you'd be hard-pressed to find something in his administration in the first 7 months that has been geared that way. And when you, I just want to, one other point about the tweets this morning. You're talking about Graham being central to getting stuff done, or Flake. Well, I don't know what he's talking about. Flake is a non-factor. Does he not understand how the United States Senate works? He just lost his health care bill by one vote. Yeah. Each one of those senators gets one vote.
Thank you.
But that's why he's so destructive. He's gotten to this point of being so personally destructive, as well as destructive to the party. He's taking on the leader of Republicans. He lost health care. And now he's got one big area left, which is tax reform that people expected him to come through on.
I wonder what this means about General Kelly. And again, I don't mean to ascribe any blame. He's the chief of staff. He's not the president of the United States. But the whole hope had been that he'd come in with his discipline and the respect that the president had for him as a military officer.
Turn the page.
And he'd be able to enforce some message discipline. We haven't seen it. So up next, we're going to talk to the one Republican lawmaker who was willing to come on the show today to discuss the president's response to Charlottesville. What does he think of the president going all in against all opponents? Next. The president is doing what he does most, if not best, which is attacking his opponents. Now that includes members of his own party. In a series of tweets, the president has called out Senator Lindsey Graham, moments later slamming Senator Jeff Flake, two men who he needs not just to empower his agenda, but he needs their votes in any political eventuality. The GOP left to pick up the pieces after the president's incendiary moral equivocation between hate groups and those who oppose them in Charlottesville. We invited all 52 Republican senators to come on the show. None accepted. We did get a Republican congressman, though, who wants to come on and talk about the state of health care and the state of our political dialogue. And you're looking at him. Congressman Charlie Dent of Pennsylvania, joining us now. Congressman, thank you for stepping up.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Please, let's deal with some of the dialogue that's hitting us over the head, and then let's get into the latest on where we stand with health care and these all-important stabilizing payments. First, what do you say to the president of the United States going after Lindsey Graham, going after Jeff Flake, going after anybody who says that he said something wrong about Charlottesville?
Well, I think it's important for the president to step back and reflect and get into some introspection here for a moment. You know, when the leaders of our top military officials, when they stand up and more or less rebuke the president with their statements yesterday, when these corporate CEOs all feel they have to withdraw from the Manufacturing Council. And by the way, I know Ken Frazier well of Merck. Mm-hmm. He's from Philadelphia, raised by a father who was a janitor. And I have Merck employees in my district, my neighbors. And, you know, he didn't do that lightly. He's a good man. I think, you know, the president ought to step back and think about this, that these people were obviously very moved. So, you know, when we get into this issue of moral equivalency, you know, I always point out when you see people in Charlottesville, you know, doing the Sieg Heil and making these Nazi references, you know, our country fought against Nazi Germany. We allied ourselves not only with the British and the Canadians and other Western nations, but with Soviet Russia. We aligned ourselves with a country whose ideology we detest. And even Winston Churchill said that if the devil had invaded hell, that he would at least make a favorable reference to the if Hitler had invaded hell, that he would at least make a favorable reference to the devil on the floor of the House of Commons. I mean, so I think we have to put it in that kind of perspective, that we just simply cannot tolerate this type of white supremacist behavior or activity. It was clear they were down there in Charlottesville to instigate a fight based on the videos that I had seen. So I think that's the message, that it's time to reflect and introspect. Jeff Flake, by the way, I think you mentioned him. He's a good friend of mine. Jeff is a very principled man. And by the way, he's one of the most good-natured people I have ever met in Congress. And I just wanted to say that about him. I don't think it's a good thing to be attacking U.S. senators whose votes you need on important agenda items.
What about the fact that you're not seeing more GOP elected officials coming out and saying and doing what you're doing right now? I get party loyalty. I get fear, frankly, or adherence to the hopes for an agenda. And that is a motivation making you go soft against the president. But on something like this, where you now have the president courting a part of the country that wants to believe that there is a left versus right race war and that it's okay to pander to the right side of that, what do you say to the other elected officials down there in D.C. with you who haven't spoken out?
Well, I think a number of my colleagues have spoken out. What I simply say is that at times like this, we simply need to do the right thing. We must, as the party of Abraham Lincoln, we have to stand up and oppose this type of racism that we have seen coming out of Charlottesville.
But don't you have to address the president the way you are right now? Shouldn't these senators, I mean, we have a list of the people who have spoken out against him. You're on that list. But there are many more who have not said, Mr. President, what you said was wrong, and here's why I believe that, and here's what the right thing is. This isn't a policy debate. This is about moral agency and standing firm about what matters in America.
Well, this issue is, I think, a real challenge for the president for a variety of reasons. During the campaign, obviously, he made a number of incendiary comments about Mexicans, Muslims, you know, the Indiana judge. There was that David Duke debacle during the campaign. Mm-hmm. And because of those previous statements, I think that has, you know, made issues like Charlottesville even more treacherous for the president, because now there's a heightened expectation that the president come out very forcefully and denounce this.
And, it's pretty easy to do, though, Charlie, isn't it? How hard is it to come out and say the KKK is all about hate? And while other groups who sometimes protest against them and protest against other things, some of them may have criminal elements, some of them may do criminal things from time to time, the KKK is all about hate. How hard is that to say?
It's not. I mean, it's not very hard to denounce neo-Nazis and the Ku Klux Klan. And my district, the end of my district is about 40 miles from Gettysburg. So, you know, believe me, it's not hard to denounce.
You know the issue, and that's why you've said it in such a clear way. So we're waiting for others to do the same. Now, to the business of the state and what matters, one of the big issues on health care is stabilizing the markets. Depending on the market, there are lots of reasons, and it's complicated, about why they are destabilized, why people are leaving, why they don't have enough choice. One of the components are the matching payments, the support payments from the federal government. The president's mere suggestion that he might not follow through with those to the extent that he could stop them shook a lot of providers and made them think about raising their rates. What are you going to do about that?
Well, Chris, I'm part of a group of folks in Congress called the Problem Solvers Caucus. We have come up with a bipartisan plan, 43 members, Republican and Democrat, and we have put down, we've set down about four or five items that we would address. One, we would guarantee the cost-sharing reduction payments through the appropriations process to bring stability. We also would establish a stabilization fund. These were two things that were very important to the Democrats. Mm-hmm. But we also, as Republicans, acknowledged that we were going to have to deal with these cost-sharing payments. As Republicans, we got relief on the employer mandate, so it would be repealed for employers under with fewer than 500 employees. We repeal the medical device tax. And we also provide for state innovation that already is allowed for in the law. So there's things here that we think we'll do a lot to stabilize the individual health insurance market. And frankly, Republicans and Democrats can each walk away feeling like they won here.
Well, Charlie, I'll tell you what. As you saw, we did with Senator Johnson. You want to come on and show your proposal and show why you think it works and make the case to the American people. You're welcome here on New Day to do it. We take the policy discussion very seriously.
Well, thank you, Chris. I really appreciate this opportunity.
All right. And thank you for speaking truth to power here this morning as well. It's a big moment in this country. Thank you for meeting it. Be well.
Thank you.
Poppy.
All right. She was on the front lines reporting in the middle of the violence in Charlottesville. Now,
they are the images that brought the reality of the white nationalist march in Charlottesville into sharp focus for many of you. HBO's Vice News Tonight got an up-close look as neo-Nazis marched through the streets carrying torches, waving Nazi flags, and chanting their racist BS. Correspondent Ellie Reeves spoke with white supremacists before, during, and after the Unite the Right rally. Here's what one supremacist said to her about the car ramming attack that took the life of Heather Heyer. Vice News Tonight correspondent Ellie Reeve. You saw her there doing the coverage. We also have CNN political commentator and contributor for The Atlantic, Peter Beinart. He has a great article you need to read that breaks down the groups that the president called the alt-left. It's good to have you both. Ellie, let's start with you. One, what was it like being down there? What did you learn?
It was crazy. It was much better organized than I'd expected. There was crowd control. They had private security. They had people handing out tiki torches. So that in itself was unsettling because it showed a certain amount of strength that I wasn't prepared for. It was also just scary because they were so angry and had so many guns.
Well, there's a reason that they are at the top of the list of domestic terror threats in the United States. What do you make of the notion that the KKK, the neo-Nazis, the white supremacists, the extreme right wing have an equal opposite on the left wing? Do you believe that notion?
No, not at all. I think that's absurd. One side is arguing that some people aren't fully people. The other side, maybe they look punk rock or something. Maybe they throw some punches, but they believe in equality and egalitarianism.
The president was making the case that there was blame on both sides, there was violence on both sides. How did you see it unfold?
I tried to stay away from the fights, but I've done some reporting. Most people I talk to do not say that Antifa threw the first punch. I mean, the white nationalists came there ready to brawl. They had helmets, shields, other weapons. They were angry men with something to prove, and I'm not surprised that fights broke out.
And you say that your experience in being with them, that not only were you surprised by their organization skills and their ferocity, but that they seem to be on the rise and confident about that fact.
That's right. More and more of them are willing to show their faces in public. They feel a sense of camaraderie. They feel that their movement is going from message boards online into real life, where they're able to hold public space. They also are able to fundraise online through the internet. That means that they don't have to rely on regular jobs where they might get fired for having terrible views.
What does Trump mean to them?
They love him. They love him. I mean, this is one of the only groups in America where Trump is routinely exceeding expectations. When he said that, when he essentially defended him, one texted me saying, "God bless this man. He truly does have our backs."
Yeah, we saw that. Thank you for passing that along to us for our reporting. All right, so Peter, this is the president's argument, okay? I didn't say that the KKK is good. I said that they're bad, but you and the media have to admit that this alt-left was also bad and that they share blame as well. Do you accept that notion?
No, I think it's a false moral equivalence. First of all, if you look at the studies of politically motivated murders over the last 10 years, the Anti-Defamation League did one, they're much, much more violent, certainly in terms of homicide, by the far right than there is from the far left. That's the first thing. The second thing is the alt-right has a connection to political power in this administration that that Antifa, anti-fascist groups, simply don't have. So even if their ideologies were equally bad, which they're not, the alt-right, quote-unquote alt-right, is much more politically powerful. And third of all, as Ellie was rightly saying, Antifa doesn't view certain religions and races as subhuman. They're anarchists, and I have some problems with anarchism, but anarchism is not an ideology of hate in the same way. That said, I do think that Antifa, which stands for anti-fascist, have displayed a pattern of violence and trying to prevent people from having the right to protest. Again, not murder, but violence, which should be troubling. It's not the same scale in any way of neo-Nazis and white supremacists, but that doesn't mean it's not a problem in its own right.
So it seems that the president is taking a little bit of truth and exaggerating it for his own effect. And that means that, do you have anarchists that go too far, which inside of Antifa?
Yes.
Yes. Do you have that same type of criminal element that finds its way into other groups that I guess you could loosely define as being on the left? I don't like ascribing the KKK to the right because, you know, when I think the right, I think conservatives, right. GOP, I don't think hate groups. But it's true. You do have criminal elements that find their way into those organizations. In the name of those organizations, people do go too far and do criminal acts. But does that in any way justify an analysis of Charlottesville as problems on both sides?
No, the two are vastly disproportionate. I think the real challenge that we need to debate as a society is, what do you do when you have people like the folks that Ellie so brilliantly profiled who come and want to march? I think that legal scholars have to discuss this, right? Free speech is really extremely important, especially in some ways for the people whose views are most odious. And so I think we need to reject the notion that because someone's views are vile, they don't have the right to march.
Right, but it's about how. Even within the law, you have time, place, and manner restrictions.
Exactly.
The president cherry picks his facts in this situation. Right. Ellie, back to you. He'll say, well, you know, the guys on the right, they had a permit. You know the history of that permit. You know the local blogger who got it and that there, you know, there was confusion about who it would be and what this march was supposed to be, kept growing in its understanding. There was a legal battle. The municipality lost. They wanted to move this march to a safer area to secure. The Nazis didn't want that. They won with a federal judge, and it gave them an opportunity to confront people in a way that would be even more provocative. So in the aftermath, and the president coming out and in this press conference saying what he said, what impact did that have on the people you profiled?
So the alt-right, these white nationalists, they have a very sophisticated media strategy. They've been studying leftist politics for a long time. And one of their goals is to look like victims. They want to make it look like police are shutting them down. They want to make it look like the city government is shutting them down. Because if that happens, it looks like their ideas are dangerous. And that if too many people hear them, they might actually like it. So this is just, this ultimately goes to their benefit.
Here's a little bit of sound of one of them trying to play the victim.
We have done everything in our power to keep this peaceful, you know? I know we talk a lot of shit on the internet, right? But, like, literally, Jason Kessler applied for a permit, like, months ago for this, okay? When they yanked our permit, we went to the ACLU, and we went to court, and we won! We've been coordinating with law enforcement the entire time. Every step of the way, we've tried to do the right thing. And they just won't stop.
How do you explain this emotion? What do you make this? What's this about for you?
These guys truly do feel like they're oppressed. They feel like there's a conspiracy to suppress white identity, to convince white women to sleep with minorities, to make white men look bad. And that is one reason why he started crying. But the other is they want to look like they're being put down, that they're just noble objectors to our current state of affairs. And they're just trying to speak their mind. And that's how they're trying to win over people in the middle.
So, Peter, what is the net effect of what the president has done here?
Gosh, I mean, I think the net effect is that these groups are going to grow because they've gotten tremendous publicity as a result of this, and they feel like they have the president on their side. And I think the result is also that we're heading towards a cycle of street violence that we have not seen in the United States since probably the 1960s. I mean, Charlottesville is not the first time. There's been brawls in Berkeley, in Portland, whole series of brawls, basically, where these folks show up. And we as a society have to figure out some way to allow them to exercise their free speech rights without allowing them to commit violence. And we need to have a legal conversation and a political conversation about how to do that, because the way it's played out in Charlottesville is going to escalate and is extremely dangerous.
Peter Barnhart, thank you very much. Ellie Reeve, I know the kind of reporting you did is scary. It's not easy. It's not easy to make it work. And you succeeded on every level, and you did it in a way that provided a moment of clarity when this country needed it. High praise, well deserved. Thank you for being on the show.
Thank you so much.
Poppy.
Thank you.
That was incredible reporting. Let the awards pour in as they should, because that opened all of our eyes even more. Ellie, great job to you. Important discussion ahead. The CEO president abandoned by the CEOs. The implications next. Time for CNN Money Now. America's CEOs abandoning the CEO president, the president dissolving two of his business advisory councils in the wake of his comments on Charlottesville. Our chief business correspondent, Christine Romans, in our Money Center with more.
Christine. Hi there, Poppy. You've heard of the Trump bump, you know, the stocks getting a rise out of the Trump presidency. Well, this is the CEO Trump dump. At least 8 executives quit Trump's manufacturing council. And as a second economic strategy council was about to dissolve, the president, he tweeted that he was going to disband both groups. Titans of business sat on that strategy council: Blackstone, JP Morgan, Pepsi, GM, Walmart. They employ hundreds of thousands of Americans. They have millions of customers. The exodus of these leaders, the collapse of the president's blue ribbon panels, an unprecedented rebuke to the business-friendly president. Now, they disagreed with Trump on climate change, on immigration, but most CEOs had been willing to work with President Trump. That is, until he blamed both sides for the violence in Charlottesville. That was the last straw. JP Morgan chief Jamie Dimon criticized the president for equivocating when denouncing racism. Quote, "It's a leader's role in business or in government to bring people together, not tear them apart." A break with business, by the way, could hurt Trump's economic agenda. He's relying on their help to push for tax reform and infrastructure. Chris, they have stepped away from the table at this point. A real, real break with business. Chris?
Well, and that's going to be a big deal for motivating the agenda, because that's what he was supposed to do, was bring the private sector in. Christine Romans, thank you as always. So as the nation tries to recover from what happened in Charlottesville, Jared Kushner and Ivanka Trump, their absence looms large. Where are they in this time of crisis?
Growing outrage over President Trump's latest comments on Charlottesville, giving equal blame to the white supremacist groups and those fighting against them. Remaining silent through all of this, two people incredibly close to the president, Jared and Ivanka Trump, who are both advisors, family members, and Jewish. Our White House reporter, Kate Bennett, joins me now. Kate, you cover all things Jared and Ivanka, and they're critical not only because of the president's children, they are among the people closest to him, advising him on the single biggest issues. Vanity Fair writes about it this morning. The other repetitive beat in the Trump-Kushner timeline has been that when things are at their worst, they tend to vanish. Why?
Well, it is interesting, Poppy. I mean, here's the thing. They are on a vacation right now, returning this morning to Bedminster, but have been in Vermont for the past couple of days. And we haven't heard from Ivanka Trump since Sunday morning about the issues in Charlottesville. I mean, it just appears to be either the craziest coincidence of these vacations and trips, of which there have been many for senior advisors, you know, going back to March when they went to Aspen on a ski trip, April on another ski trip to British Columbia. You know, there have been several vacations. It's been, you know, always timed with they were away in Sun Valley when Donald Trump Jr.'s email scandal was making the headlines.
Right.
So it is enough to sort of pause and say, where are they? And it is saying I'm on vacation enough of a reason to remain quiet.
And also so critical that they are Jewish in the wake of the comments that the president has made. Ivanka Trump converted to Judaism. They are practicing Orthodox, modern Orthodox Jews, meaning they observe the Sabbath. I mean, you also have New York Magazine reporting this morning that the rabbi that oversaw Ivanka Trump's conversion is getting political, something that religious leaders rarely do, and sent a letter out to the entire congregation saying, while we avoid politics, we are deeply troubled by the moral equivalency and equivocation President Trump has offered in his response to this act of silence. It makes you think, can Ivanka and Jared stay silent on this?
Well, I think we've seen the answer to that. I mean, it's been several days. I mean, these days sort of feel very long to us in the news cycle. However, it's been since Sunday. And I think, as you said, that they were observing the Sabbath as these riots were happening in Charlottesville. It's very telling. And I feel like the Jewish community is asking Ivanka Trump, who has a very strong brand name in addition to being a senior advisor to her father, to be an advocate for the Jewish people in this time of turmoil. And by remaining silent, I think they feel that that silence is quite frankly deafening. However, on the other side, I do feel like this is a conundrum that happens when this unprecedented situation of having a senior advisor in the West Wing also be the daughter of the president and the son-in-law. So when you sort of build these extra layers of complication, it definitely becomes, I would imagine, for Ivanka Trump, sort of being between a rock and a hard place.
Okay, but there's also right and wrong, right? And they're speaking out, as she did so eloquently in her tweet on Sunday morning, condemning this before her father did. However, I wonder if too much credit is given to Ivanka Trump in terms of how much she and Jared Kushner can actually sway the president. They have these high roles, right, in title, but they didn't sway him on the Paris Climate Agreement. They didn't sway him on transgender and the military, and she's been a very outspoken advocate for LGBT rights. They didn't sway him on immigration, you know, a long time ago. She was very upset about the comments he made during the campaign when he announced his candidacy. And clearly, they're not having an effect on Charlottesville. Are they getting more credit than they actually deserve for having any impact on this president?
Right. So her political capital is kind of, you know, shot at this point. She was allegedly going to be this Trump whisperer and able to sort of influence her father. I mean, it's an excellent question. And sort of after these scandals happen, there's this whispering that comes out of the White House a little bit of like, well, they tried, right? Like, well, she wanted the language that the president used for his second statement on Charlottesville on Monday to be more forceful. Okay, well, you know, when push comes to shove, that's an interesting storyline. However, the proof that we have to see is, as you said, has been a little bit, has fallen short. She's pushed through other issues, workforce initiatives.
Parental
she's
leave.
Also done talking points on different things with women. However, as you said, it's it might be time for Ivanka Trump to speak out.
We'll wait. They're back this morning, as you said, in Bedminster with the president. We'll watch. Thank you very, very much. Kate Bennett, we appreciate it. We're following a lot of news this morning. Let's get right to it.